FY commencing in Section 18, Bracket 1 of the United States Act, it is required of the contractors to notify SPBG of its tender offers by submitting an NCA to SPBG and providing a notice of not less than 7 days to obtain the necessary information of the cables, which are the cable plan, and as well as the transmission cable as well drawings, to engage the licensed cable detection workers to carry out cable detection work before commencing its intended efforts. Here, the HV cables. Under Section 84 of the Electricity Act, it shall be the duty of the contractors to carry some efforts near an HV cable to comply with all reasonable requirements of SPBG, to ensure that precautionary measures are taken and to allow SPBG to access the worksite, to inspect the worksite, to implement preventive measures for the purpose of preventing a cable damage. Under Section 32(1) of the Gas Act, it is required of the contractors to notify SPBG, mainly Power Gas, okay, of its tender efforts by submitting an NCA to SPBG and give it a notice of not less than 7 days. Obtain the necessary information of the location of the gas pipes, which are the gas pan and transmission gas pipe survey drawings, and to consult SPBG on the precautionary measures to take before commencing its intended efforts near any gas pipes. Under Section 32(3) of the Gas Act, it shall be the duty of the contractors who carry out the efforts near a gas pipe to comply with all reasonable requirements of SPBG. The reasonable requirements of SPBG are explicitly spelled out in the letter requirements for the contractors. The contractor is also tasked to ensure that precautionary measures are taken and to allow SPBG access the worksite for inspection of the gas pipe and to implement preventive measures for the purpose of preventing a gas pipe damage. Anyone who fails to comply with the mentioned clauses in the Electricity Act or the Gas Act is subject to a maximum fine of $100,000 or a jail term of maximum 5 years or to both penalties. Under Section 79(1) of the Electricity Act, it is required of the contractors to engage an LCDW to carry out cable detection work before commencing efforts near an LB cable. Under Section 79(3) of the Electricity Act, no person other than an LCDW or an officer from SPBG is authorized to carry out cable detection work. Anyone who fails to comply with either or the both of the clauses is subject to a maximum fine of $10,000 or jail term of maximum 12 months or to both. The Electricity Act provides the exemptions to the compliance of the above mentioned clauses just now. Under Section 79(2) and 86 of the Act, if in the interest of a public or private safety, a person, usually the contractors who carry out the emergency efforts immediately, he is required to notify us, SPBG, by submitting an NCA to us within 7 days after the commencement of efforts. Similarly, under Section 32(5) and 6 of the Gas Act, if in the interest of public or private safety, a person, usually the contractors, carries out emergency efforts, immediately he is required to notify us by submitting an NCA within 24 hours after the commencement of the efforts. We have set up a workflow for the contractors to commence
This practice will define the responsibility of the main con and the subcon and the
maintenance of cable detection markings on site serve as a visual cue to workers indicating the presence of underground cables on site. Let's now review the past cable damages. Under Section 85 of the Electricity Act, any persons who damage an electricity cable is subject to a maximum fine of $1 million or imprisonment of maximum 5 years or the both. I want to emphasize that the transmission cable damage may occur at any work site due to the similar type of earthworks that are carried out at any particular work site. For every incident, we believe that there is a gap or a lapse which has resulted in the damage. By identifying and addressing the issue timely, the incident can be prevented from occurring. Let us take a look at the first case study. Okay, this transmission cable damage occurred at inside this Selarang Park complex. Both the main contractors and the subcontractors are involved in the electrical works to provide this temporary supply to the construction site of the building. Main Khan, who was in charge of erecting the temporary switch room, is aware of the requirements of engaging the LCDW to carry out cable detection works and to submit an NC to us, notifying us of their intended works, which is the focus is on the building work. However, the subcon, who is mainly involved in electrical services provision, did not realize the need to notify SPPG by submitting an NC to us. They proceeded to construct the earth mix and sink the earth rods into the ground for the electrical earthing of the temporary switchboard without realizing the presence of transmission cables beneath and damaged the cable. These are the photographs showing the site locations. And this is the illustrations of the site. As you can see, the thesis QV cable is running across the site and where the temporary LVC room is constructed on top of the cables. The subcontractor had to bear the repair cost of the cable amounting to $115,000, and the case was submitted to the authority for further actions. All works around that area had to be stopped for around 1 month for the cable to be repaired. The maximum penalty that can be imposed to the contractors is mentioned in the slides presented earlier. Next, I will brief on this second case studies. Which is a 66 kV cable damage at this Admiralty Road West. Both the main con and the sub con were involved in the hijacking works. This is the our cable map showing the location of the damaged cable. It means constructed the receiving pin as well as the jacking pin, and the contractor had damaged these particular 6 kV cables while carrying out these hijacking works. This is a photograph showing the site location. Okay, both the main contractor and the subcontractors were involved in the hijacking work. Hijacking is the most common work to be carried out, mainly to install this large diameter water pipe as well as the sewer pipe. As you can see from this photograph, the hook circuit consisting of 3 single core cables as well as the auxiliary cables were damaged by the hijacking. As the work team had not determined the location of the establish if there was adequate vertical clearance between the pipelining and the cables. As a result of this damage, the contractors had to bear the repair cost amounting to $1.5 million and the repair took about 1 month, during which the contractors could not continue their work. Next, I will discuss on this the case study. Erection of this temporary site office. Subcontractor was engaged to install this temporary container office at this work site. They were not engaged to support this sewer diversion works where the main con was engaged to carry out. SPPG. This is the photograph. This is the cable map showing the damage location. As you can see, our electrical substation is just located beside the damage location. Installation of these soil monitoring instruments. These incidents resulted in a massive wage dip, affecting customers either way, and the contractors had to bear the repair cost of $665K. After presenting these case studies, we want to highlight the importance of positively identifying the locations of cables, and then all the stakeholders, including the project principals, can inform SPPG regarding their scope of work. Be it the minor efforts or the major efforts, so that advice can be given by us timely to prevent the incidents from occurring. Next, we would like to mention the common type of efforts associated with different types of projects. The list is not exhaustive, but the objective is to encourage contractors to engage SPPG and inform us on what is the type of efforts that will be carried out by them. More often than not, it was this works that is not mentioned in the main project scope that have actually led to lapses in identifying the locations of the cable and gas pipes, and thereby resulting in this the cable and the gas pipe damage. For projects involving deep excavation, it will require the installation of Earth-Remaining Stabilizing Structure, ERSS. The work team has to ensure the absence of any cable or gas pipes at the working area, along the shoring or the ship hauling alignment, and to ensure that there's adequate clearance of the shoring or the ship hauling from the cable or gas pipes. For mega projects like MRT constructions of Busan Corridor, and etc., there is a need to install this geotechnical instrumentation to monitor the soil conditions and to carry out this soil investigation works. The earthworks involved is vertical drilling, classified as boring works in the electricity and gas acts, and also the insertion of casing to guide the drilling. Things to take note is that what is the location of the boreholes that will be drilled into the ground, and the horizontal clearance of the borehole from the existing cables and the gas pipes. Mega projects like MRT construction of some corridor, and etc., there is a need to set up temporarily some of these, which involve the construction of earth peaks and sinking of earth runs for the lightning protection of the site office. The contractors involved has to confirm the absence of cable or the gas pipes at the proposed locations before driving the earth runs into the ground. For laying off water pipe and sewer pipes of a large diameter, it will involve pipe jacking works, where the pipes are pushed beneath the ground without having any visual cues okay to the workers on site. Usually, these type of projects will involve other type of efforts which might be carried out by the subcons, like soil improvement works and the installation of geotechnical instruments to monitor the soil settlements and the groundwater. And this type of soil improvement works and the geotechnical instrumentation installations will involve vertical drillings of the boreholes. Therefore, the contractors involved has to confirm the absence of cable or gas pipes at the proposed borehole locations before drilling into the ground. Constructions of tunnels, best soil improvement works with the installation of these geotechnical instruments. The contractor involved has to confirm the absence of cable or gas pipes at the proposed excavation as well as the proposed borehole locations before carrying out the works. Near cable or gas pipes, carrying out excavations, cable slabs, last part of your projects and to comply with the following requirements, which is to engage the licensed capitation workers to carry out capitation works. The engagement of professionals like registered earthwork supervisor and registered excavator operators to carry out the earthworks. Submission of NCE and to attend the site meetings with SPBG ESP section. Planning of diversion of services way before the commencement of the actual earthworks. Consultation with SPBG with the presence of the principal. Ensure that this LCDW capitation drawings as well as SPBG cable plans and the gas plans are available on site for reference. Ensure that this site briefing is conducted by LCDW. Appropriate trial holes are done and risk assessment is in place. Conduct the daily briefings to workers on cable and gas pipe damage prevention measures. To implement and to sustain, to maintain the damage prevention measures as well as the cable and gas pipe protection measures. To implement a permit to work systems. To conduct progressive cable scanning within the trial holes and prior to sinking off roads. It's a requirement to engage the licensed cavitation workers as well as our ESP officers who witness the cable detection on site and to carry out these trial hole excavations to confirm the absence of cables before planting the earth into the ground. And most importantly, refer to both SPBG cable plan and LCW cable detection drawings at all times to account for all the presence of all the cables on site. When in doubt, stop work and contact SPBG. You might like to ask yourself these few questions. Are there any LV, HV or EHV cables or gas pipes at the location where you're working? Have you dug the trial holes to confirm the cable locations as marked by the LCDW? Are all the workers who are involved in the earthworks brief about the locations of underground services? Are there any lock signs or markings to tell the people the locations of the underground services? And these other few pointers are mostly okay, the takeaway is to determine the absence of cables before you carry out these earthworks, like sinking of rounds, drill into the ground, horizontal drilling, or hydraulic works. You are not the first party to carry out this type of earthworks. Are you sure that you are not drilled in the mast? And we don't have these X-ray eyes to be able to visualize okay what is below the ground. Okay, as they are made in, as beneath the ground, okay, is filled with cables, water pipes, gas pipes, telecom fibers, and without checking and confirming the absence of presence of the cables or the gas pipes, I'm sure that you will hit something below it, below confirming. And so the most important thing to say is that we need to check and check again the absence of presence of this cable or this presence of or absence of this cable or gas pipes. Here are the sharing this flight deck with you later. Here's the contact details for booking via guest pipes. We have come to the end of the briefing.